There are some questions about the timing of Pfizer's coronavirus vaccine announcement that sent stocks soaring this past week. Senator Ted Cruz tweeted, quote, "Why didn't Pfizer announce their vaccine until 48 hours, literally after the networks called the race for Biden? Didn't they know last week?" Well, let's debate that, hearing from both sides of the aisle here. Welcome back to our panel, Sinclair political commentator Amisha Cross, host of the Armstrong Williams Show. Armstrong Williams, member of the President's National Security Education Board, host of America First on Salem Radio, and Sinclair media contributor Dr. Sebastian Gorka, and University of Maryland lecturer Dr. Jason Nichols. Now, I know what's going to happen. We're going to do this segment in Media Matters and say, oh my God, conspiracy theory. But, you know, Sebastian, it is just odd. 48 hours after the announcement that Biden is the presumptive, what am I calling him? Presumptive president-elect. Pfizer comes out with this vaccine. Thoughts?
Look, Eric, I love conspiracy theories. I have bookshelves full of them, but there's a reason they're called conspiracy theories and not conspiracy facts. However, you don't wake up one morning and say, hey, we've got a vaccine. How did that happen? So the idea that they didn't know this before the election is, of course, garbage. They've been working on this for months and months and months, millions, if not billions of dollars spent. They knew the vaccine was ready. It was a political decision not to announce it before the election, and that is transparent.
God help them if that is true, Armstrong. If they did, if they had any idea of this and they waited until after an election, a lot of people could have been saved. A lot of people may not have died or been sick. Your thoughts, Armstrong?
Well, you know, the White House was very much involved in Pfizer and these other drug companies, which the president often mentioned when he talked about the COVID-19 with his coronavirus task force. And so there is no question, I agree with Sebastian, that they knew. But even when they tried to take the credit away from the president, Pfizer's executive stepped in and said, no, we worked round the clock with this White House and the president's task force, and this would not have been possible without them. So I don't want to say that they were trying to weigh the elections one way or the other. Sometimes we don't always understand the timing of how this works. It worked. You can say Biden may have jumped on it and say, I'm taking credit for it now. But I think we are just true. We're so caught up in trying to read something and every little thing that happens that they had to be weighing on the side of Biden in the elections and against the president. I'm not willing to take it that far. It happened when it happened. I'm just happy to know that they have a vaccine. 90% of it is working. And maybe this will move America forward to finally get a grip on this virus that's taken too many lives.
Amisha, what do you think of this whole debate over the timing of Pfizer's announcement of their vaccine?
I think that the debate itself is laughable, because what we know about Pfizer is that $445 million was given to them from Germany to undertake this process. Pfizer is going by all the rules and regulations of approval, which meant that they had to have so many people who not only tested positive, but those who they could prove were getting better, or that this vaccine would actually be able to have prevention. And those metrics were not designed in accordance with this presidential election cycle. It just so happens that they had enough people. Again, this is after multiple trials that the announcement came when it did. This isn't something that was cooked up in some dark room, and it isn't something that should be spread as a conspiracy theory. There are scientific methods that they went through. The process is available. They've been open and honest about it from start to finish. And it's very interesting to me that conservatives now are just assuming, because of the proximity to the election, that there is some type of hanky going on. It quite frankly isn't. And it's disturbing that this is a last-ditch effort, again, to dismantle faith in systems.
All right. Hey, Jason, one of the other things that was really kind of odd to me, and I'm a viewer, I watch television across the platform. I watch left, right, and center. Was odd to me, a couple of things were happening. Immediately after presumptive president-elect Joe Biden was announced, there was massive celebrations in the street outside the White House, all over the place. There was no social distancing going on whatsoever. And my problem isn't that. I get it. People want to celebrate. I get that. But the mainstream media had no problem with what was going on in the streets of D.C. and still, to this day, continues to go on in D.C. What? COVID was cured on November 3rd?
No, I don't think that's the case. I think if you're comparing it to some of the president's super spreader events, it was the fact that people weren't wearing masks. It wasn't necessarily just the social distancing aspect. This is why, of course, in restaurants, we have to social distance because of the fact that we can't wear masks.
You're contradicting yourself, Jason. You said it's all about masks. That's why you call Trump's rally super spreader events. It was only about the masks because they weren't wearing masks. So therefore, you know, Biden is disagreeing with what you just said. It's about social distancing and the mask. Those celebrants weren't social distancing, and they could be considered super spreader events.
Eric, here's the thing, and I just first want to say I got caught in traffic trying to go somewhere during one of those spontaneous celebrations, so I'm not so happy with it either. But let me just say, Biden is correct in the sense that under the best circumstances, you have social distancing and masks, but masks are extremely important. And there are certain situations where, with the president's events, where people weren't wearing masks. That was the big issue that the media was going after. Even the events at the White House where people weren't wearing masks. And now you have people like Ben Carson who are still getting infected.
I'm not arguing the efficacy of masks. I've been wearing a mask a year prior to COVID ever hit the shores here in America on flights. Armstrong, I only have about a minute left. Another thing that I noticed, MSNBC and CNN both pulled their total number of people who've been cases of COVID and people who have died from COVID off their screen for the better part of a week. That seemed hypocritical.
Well, it is, and there's no question there is a double standard. And in the 45 seconds I have left, let me just tell you, my brother, Dr. Carson, and it hasn't even been announced that his wife also tested positive. And let me tell you, some of the things that he has described with this COVID-19, it is very serious. Whether it's wearing masks, social distancing, we need to take it serious because it is no joke with this COVID-19. And you can have all the best therapeutics in the world, but your body has to react to it and you have to recover. So we all need to be careful and cautious and not get caught up in the media's game, but realize that this virus can be deadly.
We will leave it right there, panel. Always, always great having you on. Thank you.